not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. This is just one verse. Let me read it again. For I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. What is your measure of faith? What is your measure? If you are a child of God, he has given you a measure of faith.
Yeah.
And maybe you've been a Christian for many years, and you still have a very small measure. That's because you have not cultivated what God has given you.
Mm-hmm.
But what is your measure of faith? What is your mission? Let's pray. Father, thank you for this opportunity of worship, of praise, and fellowship, assembly time together. Thank you for every person that made their way to your house today. We pray that you would meet us here and speak to our hearts in a very special way today, so that when we leave, we'll be glad that we came to your house. Thank you for your spirit. And may he be apparent in all of our lives this day, during this moment. Anoint me afresh. Anoint the ears of the listeners. Use my lips of clay. Use my mind, my heart. Use my stature as I stand here to do your bidding. And I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now I'm going to try to get through this as quick as I possibly can with the help of the Holy Ghost. So I need your prayers. The writer to the book, in the book of Hebrews, and to the Hebrew people, many have understood to be the Apostle Paul. But nobody knows for sure who wrote this book.
Amen.
But it is for sure it is anointed.
Yes.
It is an anointed book. Inspired of God.
Amen.
For the benefit of God's people.
Yes. Yes, Lord.
Those presently that are God's people and those who may be coming.
Amen. Uh-huh.
It is written for us all. And if you are a Christian today, if you acknowledge Christ as your Lord and Savior, you've already been given a measure of faith.
Amen.
And why is that important? Why has God done that? Because we walk not by sight. But to be a Christian and to live in a way that is praising and uplifting and brings glory to God, we must live a life in faith.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Walking by sight does not please God. He that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that
diligently seek him.
Not just on Sunday morning.
Right.
Not just on Wednesday. But they that diligently, every day that God gives you. Somebody said, I can't let a day go by without praising the Lord.
Without praising the Lord.
Amen.
The Bible gives us the definition of faith. It says that faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things
not seen.
Not seen. This definition is the building block by which we are able to operate by faith, because this definition tells us that faith does not deal with the natural or the tangible. Faith deals with what you can't see.
Come on, guys. That's all right.
Amen. Amen.
Others have taken a look at this definition. They have provided a multiplicity of definitions. traditions in the various translations of Scripture. The American Standard Bible says their faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the convictions of things not seen. I'm not going to go through all that I recorded, but I have a number of them that I recorded. William Barclay, the commentator writer, Wycliffe Bible Commentary, he says faith is trust in the unseen. Faith in the trust in the unseen. It's not trust in the unknown. For we may know by faith what we cannot see with the eye. And we know that all things.
All things.
Y'all not going to help me.
All things.
And I'm going to try to help you determine what measure of faith you have in your life.
All right.
Because we all have a measure.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Okay, so we find ourselves here in the book of Romans today, according to God's guidance. And Paul wanted to evangelize Rome. He wanted to evangelize Spain. He needed a local church to be able to do so. He had personal desires to visit and witness in Rome.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if he would ever make it to Rome because there were those who out to kill him.
Amen.
All right.
Because he was on a journey for the master.
Yeah.
And so he continued to press his way, trying to make it to Rome to tell them about the gospel. You know, that should be our mindset in a sense.
Amen.
That we ought to be trying to tell our loved ones about the Lord.
That's right, amen.
Maybe you can't make it across the water, across the ocean, but you can make it to your loved ones.
Yes, yeah.
If not literally in terms of geographical, you can always call them on the phone.
Amen.
You ought to be pressing your way. You ought not leave this world without telling your loved ones that Jesus saved.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And if they leave this world without Jesus, what is going to be their eternal home?
Yeah.
Now, if you don't do that, maybe you don't believe that you're saved.
Oh,
no. But Romans is an epistle that's written to every man. It is in the book of Romans that Paul says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to everyone that believes.
Amen.
To the Jew and to the Gentile. So Paul wanted us to know that we all need the gospel.
Yeah.
Amen. In our lives. At the beginning of chapter 12 in the book of Romans, Paul beseeches his hearers, his listeners, and says to them, I beseech you, better translation for us to understand, I beg.
All right.
He says, I beg you, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your
reasonable.
The fact that he woke you up this morning, you have a reasonable to serve him.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
I really don't think some people believe that. It is God that touched us this morning. Old folk, you say, talk my body. He touched each and every one of us.
Thank
and caused our moments to roll on a little while longer.
Yes.
I was talking to my wife from yesterday, and quite often I talk about my two brothers who's passed and gone on, who was younger than I was. And God called them home. And every now and then I say, Lord, why did you take my brothers who's younger than I am? Mm-hmm. But I always end up in the conversation, you know, concluding that, hey, you're a sovereign God.
Yeah, yeah.
And you do what you want to do.
All right.
I don't understand it, but since you left me here, I'm going to try to serve you.
Amen.
Since you left me here, I'm going to serve you. both of my brothers, younger than I am, and they're going on, and I'm still here. So I'm grateful that God has spared me.
Yeah.
And I can't help but give him praise.
Amen.
And magnify his name. So it's just reasonable to me to serve him.
Amen.
It's a reasonable thing. It's not far-fetched.
Come on now.
It's not going to an unprecedented level or degree to serve him. It's just reasonable.
Yeah. Amen. Yes, it is.
So, Paul says, I beseech you, I beg you, brother, present your bodies a living sacrifice. Let me put a pin right there. Can y'all hold your thought right there a second? Because I just realized I failed to mention something that's quite important. And that is, Brother Ben Burns is in the hospital. I got a call from him yesterday, which is what a lot of folks don't do when they go to the hospital. They don't tell me nothing. And then they expect me to know they're in the hospital. But Ben called me. Is he out?
He came home this morning.
Hallelujah.
Give God praise. Give God some praise. Amen. Ben has faith in God.
Amen.
Thank God. Thank God. Okay, so when we think it's all about us, we get to the point that we feel we don't need God. We don't need anyone outside of ourselves. That we're the ones that's making things happen. I woke me up this morning. It was because I set the alarm clock that I woke up this morning. You know, it was because I worked for all of those years that I'm able to enjoy a retirement life today. We think it's about us. There's a lot of folk that worked as many years as you worked, and they don't have near the income that you have.
Amen.
And you think that's about you? Oh, yes, it's about me, Pastor, because I went to college and I got my degree. God didn't have nothing to do with that. You better think again.
Amen.
God had everything to do with whatever you have. And it's just a reasonable thing that you ought to serve. Romans 12:3 said, don't think of yourselves more highly than you ought to think.
Yes, yes.
But think soberly.
Yes. Soberly.
Think soberly. Think if God hadn't given you the breath.
Yes.
If God hadn't given you the health.
Yes.
If God hadn't given you the mind.
Yes.
And he could have taken any one of those things anytime he got ready.
Yes. Amen.
Yes.
Yes, it is.
Amen. Amen.
And do what's right.
Yes.
In his sight. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. So when Paul says soberly, it means to be balanced.
Well, all
right. Balanced. Yeah. In one's right mind.
Yeah.
Anybody that doesn't serve God, and I say this without hesitation, you are not in your right mind.
Amen.
You are not in your right mind if God has allowed you to live. Listen, God could have had you aborted. God could have had someone put you in the trash can.
Preach it, Pastor. Preach it.
But you are here because it was in God's will and God's grace to allow you to be here.
Amen.
And you owe him the praise.
Yes.
You owe him the thanks for. Lord have mercy. The mindset is that they don't, y'all, those kind of people don't need anyone else to help them accomplish or achieve what they want to obtain or to acquire. They have, in a sense, put their faith in themselves and believe they can do it. they can lift themselves up by their own bootstraps. Lord, have mercy. Yeah. To truly operate in faith is to know that you don't have the power or the authority to do anything on your own. In John 15 and 5, I believe it is, Jesus says, without me, some of y'all know the word.
You can do nothing.
Without me, you can do
nothing.
You can do nothing.
Yes.
And that's why folk are dead in the grave today, because God let them go there. When he says you go, you go.
Amen.
These words let us know that our abilities are nothing without the Lord's power and his strength on our side. And so thus we have to put our faith in him.
Yeah.
And in his ability. With him, Paul says, I can do
all things.
Thank God for some Bible reading. With Christ, I can do
all things.
And anytime we say we can't, or use that word, I can't, we ought to know we in the flesh. We're not in the spirit when we say that. I can't do that, Pastor. I can't give like that, Pastor. You're depending on you. And you're right. You can't do anything. You're absolutely right. But Paul said, with Christ, all things are possible. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Ain't nothing God can't do.
Amen.
It's not only not about us, but it's given by God. James 1 and 17 says, every good gift and every perfect gift comes from above and comes down from the Father of light, with whom is not any variableness, neither shadow of turning. This tells us that it is not something that we have generated within ourselves, but that God has given us according to his will and his purpose for our lives. I am so thankful to God. I cannot thank God enough. I truly can.
Thank you, Lord.
Number one, I believe his word.
Yes.
And when he says, without me, I can do nothing, I believe that.
Amen.
I do. And then the other thing is, I know where I came from.
Amen.
You all don't know, but I know. Shakespeare said, to thine own self be true. You got to be true to yourself.
Amen.
No, you're not where you've been all your life the way you are today.
That's right.
We had Deacon Briggs, we had what they call shotgun houses. We came out of shotgun houses. And some of you have no idea what it is, but it means you can stand in the front and look all the way through to the back. Well, I can't help but to praise God. I know where he brought me from.
Yes.
And I believe his word. And I've got proof that God has been good to me.
Amen.
I've got proof. You know, some of us can't handle the pastor being blessed. I'm very much aware of that. Some still have that old mindset. Pastor's supposed to be broken, busted, and always disgusted, always crying to his church for help. Y'all wait for me to get there, huh? Not with the God I serve. Not with the God I serve. You see, my view, my limit, my focus. brothers is not really so myopic that I think that the only way God can bless me is through new songs.
All right, now. All right, now.
And some of y'all think that way. If we don't give, he ain't gonna have nothing.
All right.
That's the way some folk think. But I know better.
Shout out. Yeah, amen.
This whole world is at God's disposal to bless us. Brother Larry Jackson gave a testimony this morning. He had no idea that I was listening to what he was saying because he was so right on point. He said, I had been looking for a particular kind of job that was going to net me more money in income. He said, I expected it to come from one way, and, you know, and just wouldn't come that way. And when it didn't come that way, you know, we just thought it couldn't. That was just it. But he said, God did it. And didn't nobody understand how it happened. Couldn't understand how it happened. God doesn't have to follow protocol of man.
Right.
He doesn't have to do that. You know, if God can't find it here on earth, all he got to do is speak it.
Yes.
Didn't he speak this world into existence?
Yes.
In 7 days he made this whole earth.
Right.
And I know it's no problem for him to make a blessing for me if I need it. The problem is we try to limit God and box him in.
Yes.
Let God do what God does.
Amen.
And God is God all by himself. Common faith. That's the first thing. I'm going to give you 9. I'm going to give them quickly, so don't think because of 9 you're going to be here a long time. The first one is the common faith. All of us, if you're saved, you have the common faith.
Uh-huh.
Amen?
Amen.
Titus 1:4 says, to Titus, my own son, after the common faith, grace, mercy, and peace, from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior. This faith holds to a common belief and understanding pertaining to accepting the truths held by all those that are saved. In other words, if you're saved, it's because you believe Jesus saved you.
Amen.
That he was born of a virgin.
Yes.
He lived.
Yes,
he died.
Uh-huh.
Rose again,
yes.
Went back to his Father,
yes.
And is coming back again.
Amen. Amen.
There's common truth and common faith. All Christians should have that, if in fact you're a Christian.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
The common faith, if you will. Then there's the weak faith. Weak faith.
Well.
Romans 4:19 says, and being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. See, even though people around Abraham and Sarah did not believe that nor understand the promise that he had made to them, they believed it.
Amen.
They did not allow their faith in God to become weak because of outside influences.
Well,
some folk listen to outside influences rather than the word of God.
All right.
And when you're willing to listen to what man says,
come on now.
More than you're willing to listen to what God says, that's a weak faith.
Yes, it is.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
That's a weak faith. Because man doesn't have any power to bring anything to pass. But God does.
Amen.
And when you listen to man and spoke to God, that's a weak faith.
Yes, it is.
Some folk even afraid to bow their head and give thanks for their food.
Yes.
When they're in public.
Right.
They're worried about what somebody gonna think about.
Lord, that was true.
Those folk ain't putting no food on your table.
That's right.
Amen.
And then they do it, and they, I see him, baby, the skies, you know. No! You don't have to be ashamed!
Amen.
In fact, you ought to pray out loud!
Yeah. Yeah. Amen.
Strong faith.
Yes, sir.
This is a faith, it's the kind of faith that refuses to be defeated.
Yes, yes.
If God said it, I believe it, and that says Romans 4 and 20 says, he staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving God the glory. This is the kind of faith everyone should have, could have, if they would only persuade themselves that God is true to his word.
Yes.
God can bring it to pass.
That's right.
Whatever promise is in his book,
yes,
and you will believe him for it, you can experience it in your life.
Amen.
But if you listen to naysayers, and you listen to those weak faith people, it's not going to happen.
Yes.
I come to the conclusion one day that this life is about me and God.
All right.
Amen.
There's nobody else but me and God. Whatever happens to me is because of either me or God.
That's right.
Got nothing to do with nobody else.
All right.
Amen.
Amen.
Is God sent or God alive?
Amen.
God does. God is sovereign. We can't say God is sovereign and then limit him.
That's right. That's right.
Oh, I don't believe God's going to do that. I got to do that for myself. Well, who do you think helps self do what self do? Strong faith.
Yeah.
This is the kind of faith that everybody should have. Amen?
Amen.
Very few will maintain such a strong faith and thank God for the answer even before the answer is real. If I had time, I'd tell you about how they walked around that wall in Jericho.
All right.
And saw that wall fall down.
All
just because God said it and they believed he would do it.
That's right. Uh-huh.
And folk looked at them like they were fools.
Uh-huh.
Walking around the wall. As if God, if the wall is going to fall down just because they're walking around. Strong faith. We should all have a strong faith. But then there is what's referred to in the Bible as a wavering faith. This is the faith, this is a doubting kind of faith.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I know he said it, but. And when you put but there, you just crossed out.
That's right. Amen.
Everything that you just said prior.
That's right.
That's right.
A wavering faith.
Uh-huh.
Amen.
Amen.
James 1, 6 and 7 again says, but let them ask in faith, not wavering.
That's right.
But he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. And the Bible said, let not this man think he's going to receive anything of God.
All right.
A wavering faith. You believe today and tomorrow you don't believe.
Uh-huh.
You leave out of the church today and you're all excited. And yeah, God is good. And boy, I tell you, we had a good service today. And don't think about it no more the next Sunday.
Preach, Pastor, preach. Right. Doing a good job.
Unwavering faith. This is the faith that takes God at his word without question. In Hebrews 10, 20-23, he says, hold fast the profession of your faith without wavering. For he is faithful that promise. When you have unwavering faith, you refuse to doubt, wonder, question, or reason about one detail of what God has said in his word. You just accept by faith.
Amen.
You don't waver back and forth.
Uh-huh.
You know, even though God is a while coming to your rescue, you still just keep on believing.
Right.
And you don't let people persuade you.
Amen.
So many people's dreams have been killed by other people. Because of their doubt and unbelief. And we buy into what they say rather than what God has put in our spirit. Many of you should have your own businesses right now.
That's right.
But you let people talk you out of it. You could be doing great things today, but you kept looking around at stuff as opposed to looking to God.
Yes.
Unseen things.
Unseen.
2 Timothy 1 and 5. Paul says, when I remember the unseen faith that was in your grandmother, Lois, and he says it's in your mother, Eunice, also. Many of us started our faith from our grandmothers.
That's right.
How many of you started your faith from your grandmother? My grandmother was the one that first took me to church.
Amen.
My mother was kind of like some of the Mother's Day. My mother was young and popping. She didn't have time to take me to church. But grandmother did.
Amen.
And that's where it started.
Amen.
And I am where I am today because of grandmother.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Grandmother
Amen.
Did what she did.
Amen.
Oh, I think my mother caught up with it later on. But it started with my grandmother. That sincere, truthful faith.
Yes, yes.
Grandma didn't have much, but she had faith in God.
Yes, she did. Amen.
She didn't see all the promises, but she had faith in God.
Amen.
Bottom line to these different types, measures of faith is that they all have the same thing in common. They are a measure of faith.
Yes,
a measure. Uh-huh. Is it a strong? Is it weak? Is it unwavering? Unwavering? Or is it wavering? Is it unseen? What kind of faith? What measure of faith do you have? I'm glad I didn't stop with the faith Grandma gave me.
Amen.
I'm glad I didn't stop with that faith.
Yes.
You know, because that kind of faith back in that day believed the poor you were, the more God loved you.
All right. Amen.
Y'all don't remember that. Jesus responded to the disciples in Matthew 18:20. He said, because of your unbelief, when that man tried to heal his son who had a demon, and they couldn't do it. And when Jesus showed up, they said, well, Lord, why couldn't we heal him?
All right.
Jesus said, because of your unbelief. You just didn't believe that it could happen.
That's right. That's right.
And he said, by some things you gotta fast and pray.
Right, right.
God's word. I told you it's about you or God.
All right.
So Jesus was the only one. Listen, I'm closing. I've given you about 9 pieces, 9 different ones. Naomi, did I miss one? Okay, I'll tell you what. Just put them on the screen. Just put them on the screen. They can write them down and look at them for themselves. At the very last, I think I put it up there. If not, I'll run through them quickly myself. All right? Let me just run through them quickly myself because I want to make sure you get them. Common faith, number one. Weak faith, number two. Strong faith, number three. Little faith, number four. Little faith is number four. Wavering faith is number five. Unwavering faith is number six. Great faith is number seven. Unseen faith is number eight. But then lastly, active faith is number nine. Active faith. And each one of these measures of faith, if they are not acted upon, they're stalemated.
That's right. Man.
In other words, they're just there.
Uh-huh.
How do you grow in faith? You grow by getting into the Word.
Yeah.
Faith comes by
hearing.
Hearing. And hearing by
The word of God.
The word of God. If you're going to grow in your faith, the more you stay in the word, the stronger your faith will be. And the stronger your faith, the greater the promises that you will realize from God's word.
Yes, yes.
So it's up to you.
Amen.
In the sense that God will give it to you, but you've got to believe he can give it to you.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes, you got to believe. I'm closing. I'm closing when I tell you this right here. Because nobody died for your salvation. But Jesus.
That's Amen. Right.
Amen.
Am I right, somebody?
Amen.
Oh, you can listen to Mohammed and all of them fellas, yeah, and Hare Krishna and all, you know, they're still in the grave.
Yes, sir.
Only Jesus gave us a will. Died.
Yeah.
Came back.
Yeah.
To carry out the will that he gave us.
Yes.
That's right.
Y'all missed me. You're going to have a will for your children. For those that are left behind. You're going to make sure the lawyer has and all this kind of stuff. But when them children get through with it, when you left more for Paul than you did Peter, you don't know whether they're going to get it all or not. But Jesus gave us a will, died, came back, to make sure it was carried out the way he gave.
Yeah.
He is the only one that died for our salvation. He is the only one that was buried for our justification. He was the only one that stayed in the grave to make sure that our faith was sound and secure. Thank you, Jesus. He made sure by staying there from the three days. And that was to secure and to make sure and to make certain that what he did was going to be effective.
All right.
And we are justified today.
Yes.
Because of the death of Jesus Christ. What does justified mean, Pastor? As though I never sinned.
All right.
And y'all want to chew on that.
Amen.
Some of you can get it. Justification, he justified me. And that means as though I have never sinned. Never will see. That's why I can't help but praise him.
Yeah.
He taking care of our salvation.
Yes, he did.
But then he rose again for my sanctification.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
He rose again.
Yes, he did.
To make sure not only do I have eternal life, but that I have abundant life.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
In this life.
Yes.
Am I right, somebody?
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And then he went back to heaven for my edification and glorification.
Yes.
I'm leaving you, but I'm coming back. That where I am, there you can be also. When this mortal shall put on immortality, and when this corruption shall put on incorruption, I'm going to pull all my robe.
Yeah.
I'm going to shout around the Lord and tell the story how I got over.
Yeah.
As soon as my feet strike down, that's what he said, I'm going to shout, thanking God that I made it over. God that I got through all of this mess on earth.
Yeah.
God Amen.
Amen.
He's the one.
Amen.
That's going to get me through. I don't know what kind of faith you have today, but I hope your marriage, your faith is one that you are continuing to try to grow and become stronger in. Amen.
Amen.
So I ask you again, what is your measure of faith? What is your measure of faith? Because we come this far by faith. Leaning
on the Lord.
Trusting in His holy word. And He has
never failed. Never. Never failed.
Never failed. And those of the church home, if there's a one here today, never accepted Jesus Christ, would like to demonstrate the common faith this morning.